In the second phase of the project, the consortium plans to build a liquefied natural gas plant. In 2003, Shell announced its intention to dump 1 million tons of soil into the middle of Aniva Bay, a key fishing location in southern Sakhalin. The second phase of the project poses another hazard to Sakhalin's environment. So far, the oil from the platform has been transported by tankers. The harsh weather and frozen sea prevent this transportation during winter. To secure a year-round operation, the consortium plans to build two parallel 800-kilometer pipelines from the platforms in the north to ice-free Aniva Bay. The pipeline, as it's currently planned, will cross more than 1,000 streams. To cross the salmon-spawning rivers, Shell and its partners want to place the pipelines into a trench.
When the pipeline will be built, the company will dredge the river bottom. These works will produce a lot of sediments and silt, and the spawning area will be covered by sediments. It will bring big problems for surviving of caviar and young generation of some.
This man also warns against the consortium's plan to bury the pipelines 1 meter underground. In 1995, an earthquake with a magnitude of 7.6 on the Richter scale struck the town of Neftogorsk, an oil industry center in northern Sakhalin. Two-thirds of its 3,000 inhabitants died as 21 apartment buildings collapsed. Located on the boundary of the Eurasian and North American plates, Sakhalin is prone to earthquakes of high magnitude. American seismologist Richard Feinberg says that the pipeline is planned to cross highly active areas.
There are 22 fault crossings on the pipeline route, which is quite a lot, 22 active fault lines.
Feinberg's findings suggest that burying the pipelines in these seismic areas could lead to a disaster.
The pipeline could rupture. Now, these are very complicated engineering questions. When a pipeline ruptures, though, it spills oil. You're leaking large quantities of oil into the ground very fast and very suddenly, as if you turned on a garden hose or your hose broke.
Such a large oil spill would pollute salmon springs and drinking water supplies. But Feinberg is even more concerned about what damp Sakhalin soil could do to the metal tubes that carry the oil.
The major enemy of a pipeline is corrosion. If corrosion weakens the pipeline wall, it is more prone to developing a leak, perhaps a small leak, even pinhole leaks, that could go undetected, because a leak detection system cannot detect very small leaks. It is hard to measure.
The scientist says that such leaks could be prevented by constructing the pipeline above ground. An example being the Trans-Alaskan pipeline, which crosses three fault lines.
The Handbook for Earthquake Engineering, the chapter on pipelines, is by a senior engineer at a respected institution to which Shell Oil refers, and he is very clear. What you do in the case of a fault is you try to avoid it. Where that is not possible, you build above ground. Those are the two recommendations.
To prevent an ecological catastrophe, the second phase of the Sakhalin 2 project must be modified. Environmentalists are putting pressure on the project finances to implement necessary alterations. The European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, also known as EBRD, is a key investor.
If the EBRD would not participate in this project, the project would not exist. The EBRD is not only giving a loan together with the export credit agencies from Japan and US, but it's also giving indirect guarantees to the private investors. And those are putting the rest of the funding for Shell and Japanese companies that are involved in the project.
EBRD was founded in 1991 to help reconstruct the post-communist bloc. Currently, 60 countries own this institution. Although the bank has a clear environmental mandate, as laid down by its shareholders, it often does not follow it in practice.
Their record, it's rather bad. They are financing number of the environmental problematic projects, such as oil development in the Caspian Sea, when they finance, for example, Frontera Resources project in the nature reserve, Baku-Ceyhan pipeline going through the protected areas. They are also financing number of gold mining projects. Some of them resulted in severe accidents.
The activists also say that the consortium's tanker insurance is 10 times smaller than the amount required to clean up the Exxon Valdez accident. According to Petr Hlobil, the bank should provide guarantees that Sakhalinians will be properly compensated if a severe oil spill damages their environment.
Majority of the Sakhalin populations depend on fishing. If there is a major oil spill, then they would lose their livelihoods. Companies, but also small fishermen who are fishing for their families. And there need to be a full liability by the company.
EBRD declined to comment on the environmental concerns related to the Sakhalin 2 project. The future of Sakhalin lies in the hands of this institution. The decision of its leaders will shape the fate of this abandoned place to which we should go to worship.